work for Tactical Tech, which is an NGO that's based in Berlin, and all our work revolves around information for advocacy. So it basically means that we work around digital security, data, politics, and investigations. Everything that is around information for advocacy or activism. So how can you keep your information secure? How do you navigate the entire data world and regain autonomy, but also not self-censor yourself, for instance? But also, how can you use the data that governments and companies are broadcasting and see if what they're telling is actually the truth, or if there's a different narrative behind sort of the smokescreen that's being created?
And I would say to the average person that thinks, I don't really mind if people see what I do, I've not got anything to hide, and it's convenient to use Facebook, for example.
For me, it's actually asking the wrong question, because we've been so indoctrinated by this I have nothing to hide rhetoric that we all fall into the same trap. But actually, we do close the curtains at night, we lock our doors when we go to sleep, so we want to keep certain things private, and maybe private to other people, or private to companies, or private to the government. And I think this is where we have to sort of make a self-reflection and see if we look at our data environment and if we look at all the tools and services we're using and all the data we give away to buy a plane ticket, for instance, or to communicate to our friends, is it really that we want this data to be broadcasted to anybody who can see it and collected and stored forever? And I think if you flip the question and not say, I have nothing to hide, but do you have something that you want to be private about, whether that's talking to your mother or your sister or brother, or whether it is that you are taking a new course or applying for a job, very mundane things. You probably don't want your employer to know, you might not want your school to know, you might not want certain people to know about this because you want to keep it private in the first instance.
So the work that we do, the way that our work is manifested in the real world, is we produce a lot of toolkits. So for example, we've created a toolkit called Security in a Box, which is now in 17 languages, printed in 6 languages, and people reach the website, maybe about 2 million people per year. And we produce a lot of other toolkits, so visualization guides, and then we also train a lot of people. So we train maybe 4,000 to 6,000 people per year, all around the world, maybe trainings that last 3 or 5 days or 1.5 hours. So we also produce films under Exposing the Invisible, which is a project I work on, and animations, visualizations. So we try and make a lot of things. And then Fieke's project, which is me and my shadow mainly, which is a website, looks at how people can firstly know what digital traces are available about themselves, but also take control of them to a certain extent.
And this year's topic is creative response. So it sounds like the workshops and the filmmaking is kind of, in a sense, that's your version of creative response in a way.
Yeah, a lot of our work is around capacity building and awareness raising, and also highlighting the work of other people's responses. So we do a lot of interviews, a lot of films, to not only talk about our own work, but also the work of other people. So artists, researchers, technologists in our field and also in other fields. So bringing artists' work into the NGO world or human rights world. So for us, we were thinking about what does creative response mean to us as an NGO. And for me and my work, I think it means pushing boundaries, so limitations, how you can push restrictions, whether political or technical. And a lot of the work that we feature in our projects are people that have done those things. So Bitnik, which will be featured, I think they're being video streamed in Elevate, who made the Darknet Shopper, a bot that goes into the Darknet with $100. And then buys whatever it wants. So it came up with ecstasy and fake passports and fake Nike shoes. And then it got sent to a gallery. And then the ecstasy then got seized by the police. And then they put the police note up in the gallery. So those kind of projects that are pushing boundaries. Another one that I'd like to talk about is this project by MC McGrath, who made IC Watch, which is a collection of 27,000 LinkedIn profiles of the intelligence community that he got from LinkedIn, that people were happy to post about themselves and the projects that they worked in, all the intelligence software that they'd been working on. And actually it was a way to map how long intelligence software had been used by the way that they were talking about their on their LinkedIn profiles. So this is also interesting difference between Fieke's work and my work, where she looks at what digital traces mean for the individual, and we look at the flip side of then how you can use digital traces to expose abuses of power, or corruption. So digital traces that people have left behind on LinkedIn, for example.
And I think for me, and also in a lot of the workshops and toolkits we make, creative response is also about how do you change very abstract topics that we talk about, digital security, privacy, data traces, they're all very abstract and intangible. And how can you use creative ways to make them more personal? So there's an academic at the Royal College of Art, and he, for instance, made a graphical novel, and he asked people on the street to draw their browser history. It's something that we do every day. We surf every day. We do it for online shopping, booking a flight, going on our social media platforms, and we do it without thinking about it. And we do it without thinking about who is collecting this data and what is actually all the personal information that we give away with these actions. And by asking people to draw a cartoon about their browser history, most people didn't even know what they were doing that day. But once they started drawing, it became sort of tangible. All those things you do on the screen all of a sudden become something that you interact with, like it is going to a store or talking to your friends or your neighbors, and they become actions that sort of speak closer to people than terms like privacy or data or digital security. What I would encourage people to do is actually take a look, like open up these black boxes that we use every day, whether they're mobile phones or our computers, and play around with the settings and sort of see what you can find. On an iPhone, for instance, if you look down into the location setting and deep down in the system setting, they have a map that visualizes all the locations you have been for the last month or so. And it's really a quite visual reminder of what the data is that we transmit while walking around with our cell phone. If you use Gmail, go to your settings and sort of explore what it actually is that Google stores about you. If you look back to your search history, you can go back to 2012 for all the search queries you've ever done in Google. So explore within sort of your phone and your computer for all these different settings, and also for in the platforms we use. And then have a look at, for instance, myshadow.org, but there's also other websites where you can see how you can take really small steps to already limit the amount of data that you give to either commercial companies or put out in the public domain for anybody to see and use. And there's this false notion that to be digital secure or to increase your privacy, it has to go from 0 to 100. But there is no such thing as 100% digital security or 100% privacy. It is about all these small steps that you take and the awareness that you have. And just experiment and have fun. And these are, I think, the first things you can do. And then you'll find a whole new world of alternative tools, encryption, that might not seem so scary once you've got the first steps down.